Then my neighbors and my brother and his wife started dropping in after church and sitting around the kitchen table started talking about the Bible. They never preached at me. Matter of fact, they left me out most of the time. But I can remember Patsy saying that she was claiming a verse and relying on the Lord to save her household. Those verses are found in Acts chapter 16, 31 and 32. Again, Luke writing, he said the Philippian jailer had been woke up in the night after an earthquake and was about to kill himself, and the Apostle Paul said, no, don't do that, we're all here. So then he asked, what must I do to be saved? Paul's reply is to believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household. If you want to read those following verses, please do that. Acts chapter 16, 31 and following. This kept agitating me, if I could use that word. And I resented more and more the church, the pastor who was there. When he would come, or I would knew he was coming, I'd make sure I had my cigarettes out, and the ashtray half full of buck, and a glass of beer or a bottle on the table. And I resented him deeply. Then, in 1978, we were at a dance, and I was getting all tanked up, and Patsy didn't want to be there to begin with. And we had a dance, and we come back to the table, and I sat down, and was having a great time, and she remained standing. I said, sit down. No, Alan, she said, I'm not sitting down. I'm going home. This place is worse than hell. You imagine. A place where everybody seemed to be having a good time, one person seems to think it's worse than hell. Well, I was infuriated. I could have done a lot of things. But you know, in spite of my resentment to Christianity and those who were Christians, God was touching me. And in September 1980, actually it will be almost 41 years ago, September the 17th or 18th, I was admitted to the hospital in Fredericton. And if anybody's had a kidney stone, you know the pain. Oh, the pain that I was going through. Maybe like a woman having a child, so they say. I had no intention of ever becoming a Christian. But in the middle of the night, the Lord woke me up. Now for some this may seem a little strange, but I woke up and there was a presence in the room that was, I guess I would say, staggering. It wasn't scary. It was just peaceful. And my eyes were fixed to one corner. Now, I never visibly seen anything other than the corner, but there was a presence of the Lord in that room. Of course, I had an IV and catheter and all the other equipment that went with the surgery. I thought, I'm going crazy. The drugs were driving me crazy. And I pulled the pillow over my head. I'm back. Please. No problem. But at 4 o'clock, the knock came again. I woke up. And that time, I knew I had to get right with the Lord. So I'm kind of comparing myself to what Paul was. I was a persecutor of the church. I was a blasphemer. Not a real violent man, but there were times maybe when I wasn't the best of fellow to be around. And God, in His grace and mercy, saw fit to reach down and save me. Now, Patsy had been reading a book from Hal Lindsey, Late Great Planet Earth. And I would sneak it. You see, the Lord was working on me. And yet, I wanted to resist Him. I wanted nothing to do with it. But God reached down, and through a feeble prayer that I had read in this book sometime before, that I said, Lord Jesus, I know I'm sinning. Now, I was kind of self-righteous, although I wasn't good. But I didn't think I was that bad when I compared myself to other people in the community. You see, that's not good. We can compare ourselves to anyone. And we can look better than our friends or our enemies. But God, in an instant, took away my vile mouth. No longer did I had no desire to swear and curse the name of the Lord as I did before. One man that I worked with at the mill said when he'd see me coming, he said, I would just soon see the devil come. And he was a believer. So that's how vile I was. I had no desire to drink any more alcohol. Not that I had a lot against it, still don't. And I dumped about 3/4 of a 40-ouncer of Smirnoff vodka down the sink. I was going to give it to one of my relatives, but the Lord convicted me and said, you're only feeding his habit. And in the midst of all that, God gave me a great hunger to read His Word. And as we think about this, and as you read God's Word, you find out that when we are born with a sinful nature. And there's nothing we can do to change that except through repentance and belief in the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to read a verse that is found in Jeremiah. You know, we hear this quoted, and I've quoted this before. In Jeremiah chapter 13, verse 23, Jeremiah, talking to the people of God in the Old Testament, asked this question. Can an Ethiopian change his skin, or the leper his spots? Neither can do good who are accustomed to doing evil. See, I found this out after. I thought I was doing good. You know, I would give to this or help that, do this, do that. I thought I was doing good. But I still had that old sinful nature until that night in September when I asked Jesus Christ to forgive me and was born again with a new spiritual birth. That old sinful nature had been cut off, and the Holy Spirit came to live within me. And I thought, whoa, I won't have to make another big decision the rest of my life. But was I in for a surprise? You know, the Lord has a way I don't want to say get even, but to show us how far we went wrong. Now, when I got saved, the Lord stretched me a little bit. Not to make it hurt, but to make it feel good. So as I read His Word and studied it and prayed, God began to move again in my life. And in the mid-80s, I was invited to go on a mission trip to Guatemala. A little farther stretch. It again changed my life and my perspective on how I viewed others in the world. Then in 1988, the last part of 88, I could hear God's voice call me, but I couldn't quite hear what it was saying. Patsy and I used to call them rushes. And I'd think, oh, here it goes again. And it would be just this something overwhelming. But He began to direct me and call me into the ministry. And He pulled me a little further. It was getting harder all the time. But you see, God don't rush us. He don't torture us. He don't get even with us. He forgives us. In Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 11 through 19, in Matthew chapter 14, 28 through 30, was Patsy and I's verification that God was definitely calling us into the ministry. And then in 1989, God called us to go to Acadia for 2 years. This was a stretch that I could not have believed or could have completed without the Lord's help and Patsy doing all my proofreading and typing to get me through those 2 years. Remember, I had grade 9 education going to a postgraduate school. It's not a good fit.